do I want to talk about? I want to mention a couple of things. One, before we get started with this talk, Dr. Joseph Travis will be here in August. And the title of his talk is, What Were We Thinking? I should read the rest of it. Taking Big Science to Little Streams in Trinidad. Joseph, this guy is just a top-notch, internationally known scientist. He's funny, entertaining. You'll really enjoy his talk. I think I'll put this somewhere else. And the other thing I want to mention, even though it's a little early, we have a regatta in October called the Whatever Floats Your Boat Regatta. And it is tremendous fun. We engage people to build boats out of anything they think will float and sometimes doesn't. And then they race against each other for fabulous awards, like the Titanic Award for the most spectacular failure, which Marjorie Turnbull won, if you all know Marjorie, the first year. And she had a U.S. Coast Guard captain helping her design the boat.
Oh.
So, I mean, we're all taking risks. But that's going to be a lot of fun. And we have MARPAN, which is a recycling center locally. They're accumulating material for us so that people can go by and pick up material and build their boats. We've got a challenge out, which the law school has answered. We're trying to get that school and a bunch of other people to do it. So I think it'll be a lot of fun early October. So y'all build a boat. Come on down. Okay. So tonight we have Terry Peacock here, who's going to talk about the St. Mark's National Wildlife Refuge. And there are a number of us in the scientific community around here who have spent our lifetime trudging through the marshes and ponds and around the lighthouse at St. Mark's. I did my doctoral research down there. I absolutely adore the place, with a guy named Red Gidden, who was a biologist on staff, if any of you remember him. He was a fantastic guy. And so it's near and dear to the hearts of many of us, that whole refuge. Terry tonight's going to be talking about the Whooping Crane Recovery Program. She's been with the National Wildlife Refuge program for over 30 years. She's been director at St. Mark's for 10 years, and sort of re-inherited St. Vincent's. So she's gonna. I think you're gonna talk about the refuge a little bit as well. So with further ado, please.
Hi there, everybody. I feel a little unqualified now because Colleen Chase is in here, and she is one of our caretakers. So I'm gonna have to call on her for some of the questions. St. Mark's has been a pleasure to be a part of the Whooping Crane program since our first birds came in 2009. It was kind of an interesting situation. In case you're wondering what the Whooping Crane program is about, we're a part of what we call the Whooping Crane Eastern Partnership. And that is a partnership of 9 state and federal and private organizations. And I do have some cards back there with the websites for the private organizations. We have Operation Migration, who takes care of our birds and who brings our birds down and does the migration with our birds. And we'll be talking about how they raise our birds as we go through this program. And then we also have International Crane Foundation, and they work with what we call the direct autumn release birds. And actually, some of our birds, our eggs, come from the International Crane Foundation to Patuxent, where they're raised as a part of our birds. So we've all kind of mixed in together. And as you can imagine, it's kind of, when you're with a group that's that big and that many people, management, my committee's kind of tough. Decisions are hard to make. They've been in this program since, I think it's 2001, and Colleen, the first birds came to Florida in 2001. And so things rock along. So they did a lot of research on where they should take the birds, where they should put the birds, and how this works. And so what the purpose of this program, hit the right button here, this is our the real whooping cranes, if you want to call them that, the wild flock of whooping cranes. They migrate every year from Aransas, from Woods Buffalo down to Aransas, Texas. Well, as you know, with endangered species, you know, a lot of us and a lot of you are doing research on the oil spill and stuff. With an endangered species, when you have one flock, one group of birds, They got down to about 14 to 17. I hear both numbers at times, but they got to the point where they were trying to get this flock reestablished. It's now up to several hundred birds. I think about 300 birds. So they brought it back from the brink. But the problem is, okay, you're just one disaster away. When you have one migratory flock of birds, you're one disaster away from losing the whole population. And so what they decided then is, before we can say this bird is recovered, or this bird is now no longer extinct or endangered, we need a second flock. And so they started establishing a migratory flock. When they first started in 2001, the birds were at Mesita National Wildlife Refuge, and they took them down to Chazawitska National Wildlife Refuge, which is now part of it's down by Homosassa. Our birds were brought in by ultralights. They were trained to follow the ultralights that fly down here. Well, in 2006, they had a disaster down at Chazawitska. The thing about the pen at Chazawitska is that it is only accessible by airboat. The only way to get to it is by an airboat. You had to get out there by airboat. Some of the adult birds would come back, and they were kind of interfering with the chicks, and so they had the chicks inside a top net pen, which you'll see a picture of our top net pen when you see our pen on here. The top net pen keeps them from flying in and out. Once these birds are brought in, the pen is not really, it's just to teach them roosting. They had the birds in the top net pen, and they actually had a really bad storm come up. Well, they could not get to the pen to release the birds or to do anything with the birds, because the only way to access the pen is by airboat. Well, you're not going to put your crews out in an airboat in the middle of a huge lightning storm. So they don't know for sure if the birds, because the water at Chazawitska is very, they have a higher tidal range than we do here. Our pen is actually, which surprised me when I was talking to DEP, our pen is actually above what they consider the high tide line. Although it's tidal, we do get some water up there, but it's above the mean high tide line. So we don't get huge tidal fluctuations, whereas Chaz was in a more tidal area. So essentially, almost all but one of the birds drowned inside the top net pen. So they decided then that, maybe we need to split the flock or find a different place to put them. So I'm sitting there at my desk one day, and I get this cold call from the biologist down that was leaving, Richard Urbanek, who was the caretaker down at Chazawitska, and he calls me up and goes, they want me to stop it and look at St. Mark's. Would you guys like to have whooping cranes come there? And I'm like, are you kidding? Really? Seriously? He goes, yeah. And I'm like, okay, what are you looking for? Because he wanted to come by and stop and look. He goes, well, we're not really sure. And I'm like, well, I've got a whole bunch of acres of not really sure. Come on by, and we'll take you out there and see what we can find for you and see if we like this or not. So, they came around and looked, and Billy Brooks, who's been up here for several other things, he is the whooping crane person for Florida, and he is down at Jacksonville. So he got on Google Earth, he got to looking around, and he discovered that we had these areas. Like I said, we're actually above the high tide line. Our pen is right here now. But he went and got to looking at these on Google Earth, and he found these sites. Now, the good thing they wanted at St. Mark's, one of the things they wanted was that the pen to be accessible always. They didn't want it to be in a situation where you had to get there by boat, that you wanted to be able to go out there. And this is the area back behind where the pen site is back here, is marshy, lowland, hardwoods, thicker than you would ever want to think about. And what they told me was they wanted a place they could go in and be able to get to the birds, all kinds of weather, all kinds of situations, and they needed a road to get in there so that they could bring the birds out if we had problems out there. So they came in here and found this site, so then I started with DEP trying to get the permits and working with trying to get us a site out there. So it was we decided that we stepped, it took us a year. They called me in 2006 on their way back, or 2007, in January 2007, on their way back, and then working with WESEP and talking to them and talking to us. The thing about our pen that made it safer for the birds is that it's accessible all the time. You drive right up there, you walk out to it. The bad thing about our pen is that it's accessible all the time. Anybody can walk out there. It's in the middle of our hunt areas. We actually hunt around the pen, and not in the pen site. We have a large area around the pen that's closed. But there's hunting that occurs inside the unit. There's other things that happen inside that unit. So, when they came to me, they were like, okay, we've decided we want to bring them down there. We're going to bring them down there this December. I'm like, oh, no, you're not. No, wait. Give me a chance to do this right. And so once they came down and decided they were going to get the birds, then I started with the same thing I'm doing here, walking around talking to people. Because the only way for me to protect these birds, because you can walk right, you know, people can walk right up to our pen. It's only closed when the whooping cranes are in there. You know, it's out. People know where it's at, and we had to actually close a couple of the creeks. We no longer have the closure on the creeks because people never gave us a problem. But for the first few years, we went through DEP, had to get a lease from DEP to close the creeks. Most of you, any of you ever driven through the town of Panacea? You know, you remember when they had the big signs up there with all the bad things they said about FWC? Of course, I'm U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, but they don't know the difference. You know, so you had the big sign. So one of the first things I had to do was go to the Wakulla County Fishermen Association and tell them, oh, by the way, I'm bringing these big white birds down here, and I'd like to close your creek to all fishing from December through March, these two creeks, Spencer Creek and Cow Creek, because we need to protect these birds. I told my crew when I left, I said, don't show up for work in the morning. I'm somewhere between Panacea and the office. Just come back and find me.
In the ditch.
Somewhere in the creek.
Yeah, and it was interesting because they started writing letters to DEP because I was having trouble getting the permits from DEP to build a pen. So the fishermen of Wakulla County started writing these letters to DEP in support of the program.
Really?
And yeah, I mean, so... My boss went to a Gulf of Mexico meeting, and he was in there with all these guys, and he comes back to me the next day and goes, what did you do to those people in Tennessee? Nothing. Just showed up, talked to them, and I said, why? He goes, well, when I went to the meeting of that thing, they asked, what is one thing that you've done that you're the most proud of that affected the Gulf down here? And he said, one of those fishermen stood up and said, I helped bring whooping cranes to Wakulla County. You know, and so... That is the only way we were able to protect the pen. I made it Wakulla County's program. This was not Terry's program. This was not St. Mark's program. This belongs to the people of this area who came in and helped us do this. We had about, and you'll see some people you recognize. I don't know if Robin here, one of these or not, but this was the Wakulla County, Wakulla High School ROTC. We had to build a reef out there. They sided the pond, even though the little circular ponds were a little bit too deep for the cranes. You know, crane biologists, they're interesting people. But they're like, you know, it's a little too deep for the cranes. We need to build a reef. So underneath, I don't know if you know this, Colin, but underneath that oyster shell reef are 650-something sandbags. And so, you know, I'm looking at my staff going, I'm not filling 600 sandbags to put out here in the middle of this marsh. So we suckered the Wakulla ROTC to come and fill sandbags with us.
Enticed them.
And it was interesting because they, my staff is looking at me. My daughter was in here, and there's a picture of me and my daughter here in a little bit. She was in the ROTC, and I called them and I said, I need a crew of your ROTC kids to come out and help me fill sandbags to put in the crane pen. And the captain says, No, we can't come. We had something else going on that day, but we'll send one of the student lieutenants and a crew to help you. And I'm like, good. And my crew, Lou knows my crew, and my crew's looking at me like, you're doing what? You're bringing a bunch of high school kids out here to fill sandbags without any adult leadership but us. I'm like, yep, that's what I'm doing. And so they're like, they're shaking their heads. It's like, no, this is a bad idea. Robin was there that day. They filled those sandbags in about 2 hours, helped us haul them down to the site. And my crews look at me and go, can we have them to do the rest of the pin work? It's like, they're high school kids. They're in the back. I can't come down here and do the rest of the work for us. And then here we are tying up a net.
I remember this part.
And we had two pieces. The pin is 8 feet tall, but the conduit fencing, which is this plastic fencing that's right here underneath this, only comes in 4 foot rolls. So we had 1,750 feet of fence that had to be tied together. And so you don't want to do it in the marsh. So what we did was we rolled the fence out in the field, and the ROTC kids were filling sandbags, and the rest of us were crawling around on hands and knees tying fence together and rolling it up, taking it down. Well, then you have the fun of, okay, now we have the stuff staged down at the end of the road. How the heck are we going to get it to the pen? You know, because way out in the marsh. Those of you that have been out there, it's what, half mile from where we were, but we didn't have that road then, Colleen. We were having to bring it from the other side. So we had to come around from the other side and bring that stuff out. And this is the ROTC group that did it. They, one of our ambassadors from the refuge actually ran into one of these kids down on the St. Mark's at the observation tower down at the lighthouse, and she went up and talked to him, and they said, you know, I help with the whooping crane project. So these kids remember the fact that they helped with the Whooping Crane Project. So we're out here, we have to build this fence. Now Billy Brooks comes up from Jacksonville. Now you gotta understand, you saw the picture from Google Earth. This is a big blank marsh. We're out there in this big blank marsh. So Billy comes up to me and he says, okay, I'm envisioning this pen. Okay, good. He goes, it's gonna have straight sides down either side, and the top's gonna be curved and the bottom's gonna be curved. Now remember that when you see the picture of the actual pen. So we're standing in a blank marsh, and Billy's got, you know, we're out there with these fence posts, and he's like, here's how it's gonna look. And I'm like, okay, so he and I are out there in between putting sandbags into the thing. We're out here laying it out with a tape measure and a post driver, laying out the pen. Our pen has the metal poles underneath, and I don't know if you knew they were there, and there's metal poles underneath those white poles. Because they thought that the birds at Chazawitzka may have had a lightning strike hit one of the metal poles, there was a concern with these metal poles. So you'll see later, we sheathed ours in PVC pipe. So we have PVC pipe around all the poles. We hauled everything out with the Marshmaster. I think you know that lady right there in the green shirt.
I think that's me.
This worked really good for the first day. We put everything on the Marshmaster, hauled it out there. We were hauling sandbags out on the Marshmaster. You see all the sandbags stacked behind Robin right there. So we're hauling everything out. Worked really good. The Marshmaster broke down the first day. I tell people that I would really like to say that this crane pen went from beginning to end, and it was a wonderful plan, and everything went well, and it worked great. And I was over there laughing. Who's out there with this? It's like perfectly planned execution, and it went great. No, every day was a total decision-making process of what we're going to do next and how we're going to fix it. We ended up taking everything out by four-wheelers. We'll see them out there later. So we started hauling stuff out. We had probably, from beginning to end on this pen, about 100 people in the community who laid hands on this pen. From us, Robin came over from Franklin County, a lot of people were out here working on this pen. We couldn't have done it without our volunteers. My staff, I have my staff out there on a lot of these, but we couldn't have done it without our volunteers. So this is how our pen is put together. We've got the underneath these posts, or the metal post. And then we've got the fence around it, and this is all tied together with zip ties. Believe it or not, the whole thing is tied together with zip ties. We put the fence on with zip ties, the fence is tied together with zip ties. Everything is put together with zip ties out there. These are the sandbags under the reef. We placed about 600 of them in about 2 days, I think, or a day. So then we had to build the reef out into the pond that's out there. And then we had to go along and put oyster shell over the reef. So we hauled all the oyster shell out there and poured them out. Cranes will pick at anything. They'll sit there and they like to probe in the ground to find their food, and they'll reach around and they'll pick at anything. So we had to cover the bags because they would otherwise sit there and pull the plastic off or eat the plastic bags. So we have to go back every year and check this. But we had to cover all the bags with oyster shell. DEP donated a lot of the oyster shell for us. I guess I felt bad after all the trouble it gave me over getting my permit. So then they donated oyster shells to help us build our reef. In the meantime, you know, we still had to hit the road. We were actually coming in from another spot in the marsh and coming across the marsh to get to where we built the pen. But, you know, the whole stipulation was we had to have a road in there, an all-weather, all-accessible road that you could get there no matter what. So, luckily, we have an inmate crew, Wakulla Prison over here, sends us an inmate crew. So while we're out there working in the marsh, the inmate crew is cutting. And you see how thick all this stuff is to either side. That's what we were cutting that road out of. You know, it's just this big, thick mass of vegetation. The first time we went in there to get to the pen site to lay out the path for the road, we got lost in there. I mean, it was just, you know, it's like, okay, there's a marsh over here somewhere. We could hear the Marshmasters, like, it's over there somewhere, trying to avoid the pond. So we could find our way there. We had a GPS. We were trying to get the high dry and avoid the wet areas. It wasn't working very well. But they were working on this. We've actually covered a lot of this with filter fat, with the road fabric, the geotextile fabric underneath to protect the road underneath, and we've put gravel over it so that, because it does get wet. I mean, I think you guys were in water most of this year, weren't you, Colleen? So it does get wet still. And then they had to build a blind. This is what they look at the birds out. It's been camouflaged since then, but so while we were out in the marsh building the pen, the prisoners were up here building the blind for us. So they were building the path and the blind, and all the rest of the volunteers and myself were working on the pen. And the birds are flying down this way. It took them, luckily the birds came in January this year. This is the first year we got birds down here. And the inmates, I would come in the morning and they'd look at me and they go, did they fly today? I'm like, yeah. How close are they? I'm like, okay. And when they did fly, it's like, oh good, we've got one more day to try to build this road. Because they were still working on the road right before they got to the pen. And I'm not, do any of you follow Operation Migration online? So you know Heather. You've seen Heather's post online. Heather is a Canadian. The people that run Operation Migration are from Canada. So when Heather first comes down here, we wade through thigh deep water without the rope to get to the pen. Because she went to check the pen for us and tell me if there's stuff we need to go to the pen. At that time, we had an alligator in the pen. We've now removed like three out of the pen. But this one's in the pen. So I go out there and I'm wandering around and I'm looking. And I'd already put some baits out to try to catch it. And we'd already done some stuff to try to catch it. So I checked the bait and I don't have the alligator. And Heather's walking around out here. And we just, remember now, we just waded through thigh deep water to get to the pen. And so we're walking around, and I'm like, okay, I think it's gone. I don't think it's in here. And Heather stands there a minute, and she looks at me, and she goes, if it's not in the pen, where is it? And I said, Heather, do not ask a question to which you do not want to know the answer. And she looks at me, and she goes, you're carrying me back to the truck. And I said, I told you, do not ask a question you don't want to know the answer. She walked back with me, but she wasn't real happy about it. Once we built the pen, we did build a gate. The gate is our weak point because you can't cover underneath here. Everything around the pen, you see the pen, we've got the pen. We have an electric fence that goes around the pen to keep predators from coming in. And then we have bull paneling down the bottom to keep the alligators out. Well, the problem is they're coming under the gate. We did finally put sandbags last year under the gate because they would dig under the gate to get back into their little pond that they didn't think it was very funny that we took it over for whooping cranes. But the this is not really to keep the birds in. A lot of people think the pen is to keep the birds in. Our birds are free-flying birds. Once they get here, after they've gone in the top net, had their health checks done and everything that goes on, they are free-flying birds. So this is to keep predators out. We've had some predation problems, and we'll talk about that later, but that's outside the pen. We've never had a predator get inside the pen. We crank up the electric fence, and they all decide that that's not really a cool place. We do have birds and stuff that come in with them. They tolerate some of the birds. They don't tolerate the wood storks very well. I guess they're just too close in size or don't like them. So we had to go ahead and put in the gates. Then we built a feeder station. This was kind of fun because we built this feeder station, and we built one the first year. The next year we had more birds coming. So Brooke's like, we need a second feeder station. So, like I said, we also posted it. Go back. The feeding station, the first year we put the feeding station out there, and then they decided we needed another feeding station. And so we put the other feeding station out there, and the year that we went, it was me and a bunch of our older volunteers, no offense to any of the volunteers in here that may have helped me, from the photo club. And we had to carry the concrete, the posts, all the wood, and somewhere I've got the picture, and Lou's got one over here of the girls, so we carried all the stuff out there to build the feeding station. And I'm looking there going, next year, it is not going to be me and just the people my age out there. Not happening again. Not, no. And so we've got a High School AP Environmental Science class. My daughter was in that class that next year, so she came out. And somewhere in here, I thought I had a picture of her with her group, Lou, that you took of them. But she came out, and they all helped us on the crane pen the next year to help us get that work done. So I think it's later in the slideshow. And they did great. Huh?
What do you feed them?
Crane chow. I don't know, does Perina make it or where do we get it from?
It's a special formula. It's really close to a turkey chow.
It's grain.
It's a pellet.
Yeah. But our birds, the thing about our birds is those ponds out there hold a lot of crabs, and we have a lot of fiddler crabs in the area. So our birds, to me, rapidly learn to feed themselves. They come back, and the bad thing is, and we'll talk later, is future birds coming back, it's kind of hard to get rid of them. We did the sensitive wildlife area. So the last thing we did was close everything off, put up the signs, and to keep people out. We do allow if you notice, we don't close it until December 1st. I think they've only gotten here one time before December 1st. They came in one time right after Thanksgiving. So we do allow archery hunting in here. People archery hunt. around the blind side and in the area, and we've not really had any problems. We one time had a guy come in with an ultralight, but since we've made this part of the areas program, we've not really had a lot of problems to trespass into this area. It's been a great program, and people appreciate it and enjoy coming down. So while we're doing all this work, up at Patuxent Wildlife Refuge and Wildlife Health Center, they start raising our birds. They actually bring in the eggs from, they come in from Patuxent itself. They have a breeding program at Patuxent where they have the birds there. They come in from International Crane Foundation, and they come in from surrounding zoos. We have the Audubon Zoo that has them. We get some from Calgary. We actually get some from Canada that come in. So a lot of these eggs get shipped either here or to International Crane Foundation, and they're raised in their incubators. And these, I went up this winter to Patuxent, and their incubators were just really cool. They're the big old wooden incubators. They're still using the old wooden ones up there because they seem to work the best with whooping cranes. They actually expose these birds to the sound of the ultralight at this stage. They start playing the recorded sounds of the ultralights at this stage to get them used to the fact that they're going to be following the ultralights. And when we use these, and they've got a lot better costumes now. They actually have a shield on here because they will go after your eyes and anything else. They look pretty, but they can be kind of mean at times. I haven't asked as much as Colleen has, but they can be mean. This is not really to make them think that we're a whooping crane. A lot of people think that. It's not really. It's to hide the human form. We don't want them thinking of humans as their food source. So it's really to mask the fact that we're humans, and so we don't talk around the birds. You don't go out there. You go out in this costume to hide the fact that the human form, so that they don't start associating. It's just like, you know, most of you know about feeding bears and feeding alligators. You don't want them associating humans as food. And so they don't want to, we don't want them getting too used to it. Although we do still have occasional problems with them going into bird feeders and stuff like that. Most of ours on St. Mark's have stayed pretty wild. They're not going close to folks very much. They start teaching them using the puppet heads. This is our control method with the puppet heads that look like the adult whooping cranes. They start teaching them when they come out as chicks to go ahead and feed on the crane chow and get ready to come and move down here. Once they get big enough to move around, they'll swim them, and then they start circle training. And these are the ultralights with the wings removed. And so they'll guide them around the circle. They actually start the circle training at the Patuxent. They would ship them previously in this program to Nisida National Wildlife Refuge. Well, later I'll talk about some of the issues we're having with the population. One of them is that Nisida, they're having nesting problems. So the last, do you know what you removed, Colleen? I can't remember. 2011,
I think, was the first.
Yeah. Time. So we moved over to White River Marsh in Wisconsin, out of the Black Fly territory. And so a lot of the birds that are coming to St. Mark's now are from that White River area. They're coming down from White River Marsh. So they'll take them, get them in here, and then they'll put them in crates, ship them out to the training facilities outside of, this is in Maryland, so they'll ship them out to Wisconsin where they're going to be trained and teach them to follow the ultralight. And that's how they get down here, is by following the ultralight. Now, those of you, how many of you here have been to one of the flyover events? Anybody? Yeah. If you've not been to one, we'll talk later, but this may be one of your last years to see it. I really recommend it. I've been on both sides of the flyover events. The first year that they were bringing birds down here, I had spent several months out building the pen, and then we're getting ready for the flyover event, and I looked around and I said, you know, I have a perfectly good public use person here on the refuge. I'm going to the pen. So I was not at the first flyover. I was actually in the pen watching the birds put their feet on the ground inside the pen that we just built. So Robin had to handle the 2,000 people at the first flyover. I've gone to both, and each one is equally impressive. It's really neat to see these birds. And Lou, when you get a chance, Lou Kellenberger brought some pictures up for me. And Lou has one of a flyover here and some of the pictures back here of us at the flyover event. It's neat to see them. They come in. You can hear the ultralights and hear the birds a long ways away before they come in. Of course, the whole purpose is to get migrating birds down here.
Why would this be the last time to get this?
I'll get into that for you. Yeah, I'm going to cover it later what might happen.
Another question.
And here's our pen.
Do they land the ultralight in the pen?
No, they have not had to do that yet. The first year they came, if you look right here, this is our pen. Now, you remember what I said about Billy with the straight lines and then the curve on the end? He built this out of his head in a blank marsh with a tape measure and a post driver. We were out there. He goes, "Oh, put this post here. Put this post there."
Wow.
So we built that. This is the top net. That's the top net pen that we're talking about. It has a net over top of it, and then we put them in there when they first get there, so they can have their big boy and big girl bands put on, and then they do a health check on them usually. And you can see right here, these are the birds right here that were coming in. They have a caretaker. These are the two. This was Jane Chandler and my mind just went Jeff. Who's the other guy from Texas? My mind just went blank. Jane just retired. These were
Charlie or Robert?
No. But anyway, they came in. Jane, it was pretty neat for her. She just retired a few years ago. She actually does all the rearing. She does all the rearing at Patuxent. So this was really cool for her because she got to see these birds land in the pen. And so she got to see from beginning to end. From when she raised them from an egg and raised the chicks and all this stuff. And then got to see them free and flying into the pen.
And we only get nine?
We get however many we get. There's several different whooping crane programs going on. So every year it's always a fight over who's going to get what eggs and how many. So it's this year we only have six actually coming. So it's different things with the program.
Why are the ends of the pen round?
That's just the way he wanted to build it. Yeah. But I thought I was just pretty impressed that was his vision in his head. When you looked at when I saw the picture from the air, I'm like, wow, he did it.
I can answer.
Okay. That.
You don't want 90-degree angles so the bird can't be trapped by more aggressive birds.
Yeah. This pen is about 3 to 4 acres. Like I said, 1,750 feet around. Yeah.
But those were natural ponds, weren't they?
Yes, these are natural ponds. The reef, however, that's the reef that we built. That's the one addition we did to the ponds because they wanted the depth to be right for the birds to roost. So that's the reef that we built out there. People asked me, I was in the pen when the birds arrived, and you asked me if they had to land. This time, they told me when we were talking to them, because there are salt flats all around out here, so if they had to, they could put the ultralight down on the ground and walk the birds into the pen. And when I was talking to Joe Duff and Brooke, some of the guys were flying, they said, these birds have never landed off the wing. He said, every time we've had to move them, because they migrate them all the way across country, stopping as they go across country. He said, they've never landed off the wing. Is the marsh dry enough that we can put these ultralights down if we have to? And I'm like, yeah, sure. One circle and they hit the ground. They were off the wing the first time. And that was the first time in the whole time that they had gone off the wing. It hasn't happened that way in years past. I've had them come down. I think a couple of years ago when I was in there, Brooke actually dipped the wheels of the ultralight into the pond trying to get them to drop and flew straight towards the blind. It was really kind of cool. But probably not for him, but we thought it was cool. But they landed right in here and they put them in the top net. And people asked me, and it was interesting, and I didn't bring the video tonight. If you ever get a chance, you need to see the video that our photo club made for us. They said, did you cry when they hit the ground? I'm like, no, I was worried about getting the pilots back to the, because my next job was to get round up all the pilots and bring them back to the flyover, because everybody was standing there waiting to talk to the pilots when they came in. But it was a nice culmination to see these birds come in and land inside this pen, so that we had all worked so hard to do. Here they are. The pen doesn't maintain itself. This is an annual event. We go out every year, take people out to the pen, do all the maintenance work on the pen, tying up everything. This young lady right here is my youngest daughter. This was her class. It was out here, and it was funny because, like I said, after the year before when I had to build that feeding platform all by myself with all the older volunteers, I'm like, so we brought these guys, and once again, all the guys are looking at me going, you brought a bunch of high schoolers out here? You're going to like, what are they going to do? They're just going to get in the way. Luke can tell you, they worked us into the ground and under the ground and had enough energy for a mud fight after this picture was taken. strung all of the electric fence wire, did all the work for us, tied up everything. It was great. I bring in kids from the high school. This year I had a girl from middle school. We had a lot of FSU students. We try to still continue to make this a program that is everybody's program. So every year we come in, and I do have cards back on the table when you leave that has my name and number on it. Typically we do this in mid-October with the false hope that it'll actually be a little cooler. it never really quite works that way, but we have this false, security that might be a little cooler the day we do the pen work. But we do it about mid-October. We have a crane pen work day, and people are welcome to volunteer. You see what we're in, though. It's a half-mile walk to the pen through the vegetation, it's got a nice road there, but then we're out in here all day. Some days it's dry, some years it's knee deep. Depends on when the tide hits. I don't check the tide charts before I schedule my crane pen work day. So welcome to come, but just remember what you're going to be in. You know, it is a hard work day. It is a work day. We're out there slogging around the stuff and wading around and working on the fence, working on the reef, working on the top net, just repairing everything that got damaged. The whole purpose of this whole program is to have them come back. You know, the chicks are cool. We bring them down and we have them come back. These are 2013's birds. Two of the 2009 birds stay at Southwood every year. They come back. I think a lot of these pictures are those, aren't they, Lou? The 2009 birds.
Yes.
Luke Kellenberg, if you get a chance, come up and look at these pictures. These are some of the Southwood birds. That's about the only place you can see the adults, because ours usually come back to the marsh area where they're not. They came back to Lighthouse Road. I went to the oil spill in 2010. I was over in New Orleans working on the oil spill. And I'm sitting in a, you know, they have all these wonderful conference calls on the oil spill. So I'm sitting in the conference call, and I'm sitting there looking, and my phone rings, and I look down, and it's like, that's the refuge. So I turn it off, sit there a minute. A few minutes later, the phone rings again with somebody else from the refuge. Phone rings again, somebody else from the refuge. I'm like, okay, something's wrong. They don't call me this much. I've got to go out and take the call. Step out, and I call them, and I call Joe Ryman, and he says, Terry. And I said, Jake, I'm standing on the levee looking at four whooping cranes in Stony Bayou. Okay, that was worth missing the conference call. Cool. And then I start getting pictures. Lou sends me pictures. All the people are sending me pictures. I'm like, oh my God, they were too close to these cranes. So I'm back on the phone again. Get the people away from my whooping cranes. Back them off. Do something. So then they left. And James calls me. James, the project leader of the North Florida Complex, he calls me and goes, we're sorry you ran them off. And I said, I doubt it. I said, somebody needs to go to the pen. I said, somebody go to the pen and check. And a little bit later, I get a call back. Yep, they're in the pen. Wait, so they went on over. And so now they don't, we have not had any other, we had last year, some of the birds actually flew by Stony Bayou. But they, for some reason, are not that public oriented. The people get around them and they're like, no, we'll go back over here where there's nobody. So they've been good about doing that. The future. I'm going to go back to this picture. One of these birds is still alive. Excuse me. These birds came in. This is actually in the backyard of a private landowner in the county. They flew onto the refuge and then they went to his yard back there. I got a phone call. One of my maintenance guys calls me and goes, you need to call this guy. I'm like, okay. So I call him and I'm like, I understand you might have something in your yard that I'm interested in. He's like, maybe. Nice older fella, drive over there, talk to him. They stayed in his yard for a long time. There were five of these to begin with. One of them actually got taken by a bobcat on the refuge. Excuse me, y'all. The other four, this four, moved off of his property into a wooded swamp. We're not sure exactly what happened in that wooded swamp. We had a really bad storm one night. The day that they came up to do the banding, one of these, the females, showed up with a broken leg. A few weeks later, we had satellite transmitters on these birds. We couldn't find them. Colleen, Brooke, all of us were out there looking for these birds. We couldn't find the two missing birds. One of the birds came to the pen and said, okay, this is where I'm staying. He stayed there the rest of the winter in the pen with our chicks. We finally found the two carcasses inside that wooded swamp. By that time, they were so degraded that we couldn't really tell what happened to them. I don't know if they hit a tree. I'm assuming that's what happened to the female that had the broken leg, because we had a storm that night. She hit her leg on something flying out of that wooded swamp.
Maybe a power line.
Well, no power lines around. It had to be a tree because she came out of the swamp. Could have been a power line. The other two, we don't know if they hit something and died or if a bobcat took them. The transmitters were chewed up. We assume it was a bobcat. Later on in the same year, last year, one of our chicks got taken by a bobcat. So we had at least four birds that were taken by bobcat. That's where we get to the future. The whole purpose of this program is to have birds return down here and to have birds in the flyway to have them successfully breeding. We had one problem with the successful breeding. At Nacita, we had 30 nests this year, and I think Colleen said we're down to about four chicks that survived. Obviously, these birds have a problem with predation. They're raised in captivity. they're raised by caretakers in captivity. So they really, you know, it takes them a little while to get it. You know, the one bird that survived last year, he's probably pretty good. He's down with, we don't hang around bobcats. You know, it was an expensive lesson for the program, but I'm pretty sure he's pretty predator savvy now. The adults also would sit on the nest, go all the way to almost hatching, and abandon because of black flies. That's why we moved out of the Sea to National Wildlife Refuge over to White River. Our birds are just now getting old enough to start pairing in the White River marsh. So we don't know yet if that is going to fix the problem, if those birds are going to raise. These birds usually don't nest until like 4 or 5 years old. They're very slow to mature, which is usually usually endangered species do have several problems, one of them being slow to maturity, another one being low reproductive rates. And so these guys can lay 2 eggs, they usually only raise 1 chick, so they'll go out and get the second egg sometimes, so they go back into this program. Down here, the question is this a safe place for them? You know, we're debating that question right now. I'll be attending a meeting with the 9 partners in September to discuss whether this is a safe place for our birds. I was very disheartened last year. I was ecstatic when they came back. That's what we tried. That's what we fought for. It was a very hard year for me. You know, it started out the year just completely ecstatic that we had these birds back down here. Found them in private land. They were hanging out in the area. And then to lose 4 of them, I was heartbroken. It was a very hard year for us. I told them this year, I said, you know, the people of Wakulla County have put a lot of effort and a lot of time into this program. Not just me, but everybody. People sitting in this room, and people love these birds. And so I begged them, please let me have them this year. At this point, I think we're going to get them this year. We've got 6 birds that I think are coming to us this year. It may be our last year. I don't know. There's a lot of other places that are talking about stopping the birds on the route. The birds have spread out all along the migration route, which is appropriate. That's what they're supposed to do. And so they're looking at other places where they would take the birds along the migration route where they don't have to haul them all the way down to Florida. A lot of debate, a lot of science going into it, a lot of questions. And so we're at a question point. We're at a turning point in the program. What are we going to do and how are we going to get these birds? We've tried parent rearing. They're doing some parent rearing now where the people at Patuxet put them with their parents to see if that helps with this predation issue, if they're raised by actual whooping cranes instead of raised in costume. You know, it's a tough program to be a part of because it's hard to make these decisions. You know, I've been involved in this from the beginning since they started coming here in 2008, and, you know, they're my babies, it's my program, but I want what's best for the birds. And so whatever decision that we make in Wisconsin in September, I hope it is the decision that is best for the birds, because that's what we're here for. We're not here just to bring them to me or just to bring them to Wakulla County. We're here to get a free flying flock of whooping cranes that is self-sustaining, and that's what we're working on. So, you'll hear about it. I'll keep you posted as we hear, look for the newspapers and stuff.
Well, are there bobcats in Texas? I would think that there
are. There are, but it's a more open habitat. Now, and we're burning, in the next few weeks, we're going to be burning the crane pen area, which will open up the habitat more. We're about to get the helicopter up and burn it. So we marsh master around the pens. We did have a bobcat take a bird a few years ago, so we marsh mastered around the pen. So it's, interesting and things you have to do.
Historically speaking, is this area actually an area that was once inhabited?
Yes, it is. Yeah, it was part of the traditional crane habitat. Yeah, that's why they selected these areas. And they're trying to move them far enough east so that they don't interfere with the wild population. Because these birds have been raised in captivity, we don't want to introduce anything that may have been picked up in the captive facilities to the wild flock. So they've moved them over far enough that they're out of here. Now, we're not just about whooping cranes. You know, it was interesting to me when the birds were coming down, everybody was following them on Operation Migration. I got calls from the public to tell me they were at the staging ground in Jefferson County. I'm like, really? I'm kind of busy right now. I'll check in a minute, you know. So, we don't just do whooping cranes. We have public, I think Lou or Betsy took this picture. We have a lot of public use on the refuge. This is one of our festivals called the Hoot Festival. We also have the Monarch Festival. We allow hunting and fishing. You know, hiking, bird watching, all kinds of stuff happen on the refuge
research,
as far as public
don't
use.
Don't forget
research. Research, yeah. We have 1,800 acres of wetlands that we manage on the refuge for waterfowl, shorebirds, wading birds. We also prescribe burn. They're prescribed burning today. I feel sorry for them, yes, it was a very hot day. They were out prescribed burning. This week we'll have burned around 1,100 acres by the time they get done burning this week. We burn year-round for timber management. We're also doing some, what we call, this is mowing underneath some of the longleaf pine in the area to the north of the refuge that we just purchased. We're trying to get up there and do some active management. We manage a lot of endangered species, and so we're trying to get this ready to bring over another colony of red-cocked woodpeckers, so we're working on that. Down by the, you see the blue paint on the trees right here? In the next few weeks, we'll be starting a timber sale. We're getting the timber marked right now up by the refuge and some of the St. Joe paper company that we took over. We're actually going to start, you notice it's a little thick. It has never been thinned, so we're going back in to start thinning this and start going back into areas where it's appropriate. We'll be actually restoring its longleaf pine. We manage the red-cockaded woodpeckers. You couldn't pay me enough money to climb that ladder. I was on the ground, but you didn't know. I don't want to climb that ladder. We go up. We have a very intensively managed red-cockaded woodpecker population. They're banded. We go out and do the fledge checks. We band all of our chicks, so we have a lot of work done on that. This past year, I got a call from, we did what we call a strategic decision-making process on the whooping cranes, and it was horrible, really horrible. You know, we went through this whole thing, and you know, you got 9 people in the room that are all heads of agencies and all the other stuff, and got all these people, and very hard time making decisions. So the USGS people at Gainesville came to me and said, we need to talk about flatwood salamanders, frosted flatwood salamanders on St. Mark's. We think we need to have a strategic decision-making meeting. And I'm like, I would rather take a beating than to go to that. So then people come telling me, we have people doing a lot of research on these and looking at them and looking, and they come in saying, Terry, your population's crashing. So the third individual who were out there researching who came in and told me, Terry, your population's crashing of these animals. They're only found in 2 places, St. Mark's and the Apalachicola National Forest. So I go to the phone, pick it up, call Susan over at USGS and said, okay, let's talk about that strategic decision-making meeting thing you wanted to do. So we went ahead and did it. This year we actually put traps into our ponds to trap the larva. We trapped all 52 potential salamander ponds on the refuge. My lovely interns went out there and did all this work on this. Trapped them. We found 8 occupied ponds, which is more than we thought we had. It's still very low. So we're actually working right now on the area that they're burning right now is one of the flatwood salamander pond areas that we need to summer burn. So we burned 15,000 acres last fall, getting it ready for summer burns next year to protect the flatwood salamander. So, and if I didn't have enough endangered species, we think that there's a possibility there's a vole down in Lower Suwannee that is endangered. So, you know, Billy Brooks is the vole. He's the vole biologist. It's a little hamster. It's a little mouse-looking thing. And so he's the vole biologist. And when we were the whooping crane, he goes, I think I saw a vole. I'm like, well, good, I'm going to teach my whooping cranes to eat them. He says, maybe if we have voles in a suitable habitat, they're not endangered. So he suckered me into trapping for salt marsh voles. These are camera traps that we put out into the salt marsh. And there's Kenworth, for those of you that are from St. Vincent, working with us. We put the camera traps out in hopes that the voles or mink, we're trying for both, will go in there. So like I said, if I don't have enough endangered species, I'm out actively looking for another one to add to the refuge list. The interns are an interesting story. I have some of my St. Mark's board members and supporters here right now. We have a development committee from St. Mark's that's out talking to people who donate money, and Dr. Ed Carney donates $10,000 a year to support our intern program. So he's the one that pays the stipends for our interns and provides our interns. And we've been running 2 interns every semester out here on the refuge. It's working. We couldn't have, these guys trapped 52 salamander. Poor Kim Lynch. She's over at St. Vincent now. She's like, I never want to see another frosted flatwood salamander larva as long as I live and trap another pond. But that wasn't what they signed on for. That's what they got. The lighthouse. We took it over in October of 2013, right in the middle of the shutdown. Loads of fun. Got a call. I was the only person on the entire refuge. Got a call from the regional office. We finally just signed the transfer documents for your lighthouse. I'm like, well, that's just great. Can't tell a soul. I'm sitting here by myself. This was a, you don't see this picture of the lighthouse very often. I brought this one because it shows what we're doing with the lighthouse. Our St. Mark's Refuge Association, once again, is working to try to raise money for capital campaign. We got a grant from Florida Lighthouse Association. One of the first things we had to do was to take the light out of the lighthouse. If you've not ever seen the Fresnel lens, it's in our lighthouse. It's now sitting in the visitor center. And this was an interesting day. This lift right here was donated by Ring Power. They actually came down with the lift and the operator to help us get the lighthouse out. When we first started about taking the lens out of the lighthouse, my maintenance guy calls me. He and I sit down. It's back to the crane pin all over again. We have this really great plan. We're going to crate the lens and take it out of the lighthouse. So it's safe. You know, these things have these prisms that are, what, $30,000 a piece is what they're telling us, you know. So it's like, okay, we're going to do this. So Chris goes up and he measures the floor. He comes back and he goes, Terry, it won't fit through the floor. The only way to get into our lantern room is to climb up a ship's ladder and then the Fresnel lens is too big, it won't fit through the floor. And I'm like, well, okay, let's come up with another plan. So then our plan was, once again, to crate it and take it out the window. We took the window out of the lighthouse, so we were going to take it out the window. We have to have the Fresnel lens out because we can't work on the lantern room to repair it with it in there because it's probably the most expensive and priceless piece of the entire lighthouse. And you can't bump it, you can't touch it, you know, so we're like, okay. So then Chris goes up there, I said, okay, we'll crate it and take it out the window. Chris goes up, trusty tape measure, measures again, comes back and goes, Terry, oh my God, I don't want to hear this. He says, there's only a quarter of an inch to spare on either side of that lens coming out the window of the lighthouse. I'm like, so you're telling me that that thing has got to come out of there not in a crate? He goes, yep, that's what I'm telling you. I'm like, okay, not liking this. So that's what we did. We brought it out here. And it took them a while. They've got a ramp here that you see that they slid it down to put it into the bucket that came down. And in the middle of all this, I'm standing over here on a tower watching with a bunch of the volunteers and my husband and his dad and everybody. We're standing there, and Chris calls me on his cell phone. I'm like, I don't want to answer this. What the heck is he? What have they done to my lens? I answer the phone. He goes, it's going to be about 5 more minutes. I'm like, you just gave me a heart attack. That was not even funny. We got it out safely. If you want to see it, it's sitting in the Ponce Leon Inlet Lighthouse down in, where are they at, Lou? My mind just went blank.
Just south of Daytona.
Just south of Daytona. Sent up curators. They actually, we have to, there's such a thing as a lampist, and that's what they do is they fix these lenses. And so because it's a historical thing, we had to have a certified lampist. Well, to hire one of the 3 or 4 certified lampists in the country would have cost us $30,000 to have the lens restored. Ponce Inlet did it for free. We paid for their materials, we paid for their travel up here, they did the restoration on our lens, and we brought it back up here, crated. So they did all the work for free for us.
They did a fantastic job.
It's beautiful. We did not repair the lens. We had a big, long debate about whether to repair it. It is what they call preserve. They took all the damage, they cleaned the prisms, they cleaned the brass disease off of it, got it all set, but it's came back with all its nicks, missing prisms, everything in it, so the history is still there of the lens. It's just now sitting in the lighthouse.
How do you get it back in?
We're still having that debate, too. The same way we took it out. If we decide to put it back into the lantern room, it will go in through a window. So it'll have to be lifted back up and put back in through the window, so... Yeah, I had a reporter there asking, you're going to put it back in? And I'm like, let me get it on the ground in one piece first, then we'll talk about what's going back in.
So, uh-huh. Will it be a functioning lighthouse again?
No, not at this point. We're not going to say not ever. Right now, it is a functioning lighthouse. That is the issue. It is the back, it's a rearranged light for the Coast Guard. There is a light, I don't know if you can see it here, but there's a solar panel and a light on here on the outside that flashes. So it is an active lighthouse. And our Fresnel lens would overpower the rear range light. And apparently those are kind of important. The Coast Guard didn't think it was very amusing when we asked them if we could relight the light. If they ever abandon the lighthouse, that will be our push, would be to relight the light. And then we would put the Fresnel lens back up there. We do a lot of work with young people. This is a young man, and that's a red-cocked woodpecker there in my hand. But this is a young man that goes to church with me. Work a lot with young people. We bring in a lot of interns. Thanks to St. Mark's Refuge Association, we bring in a lot of people with the school, trying to get people out and hands-on and on the land and working on St. Mark's. So we have a lot of stuff going on. Photo credits, Lou and Betsy Kellenberger took a lot of the crane pin. Whooping Crane Eastern Partnership, the Chicks, some of those are my pictures. David Moynihan and Greg and Kale Kittendorf. A lot of people that have put a lot of time and effort into the work out on the crane pin and into the refuge. Thank you. Lou, it's nice enough to get pictures up here if anybody wants them. Help yourselves to them. Lou, it was nice enough to bring those for you today. You can't have my friend ones. You can have those on the table. I do have a card back there from St. Mark's Refuge Association. They're our support organization, and we could not do a lot of our stuff that we do without the St. Mark's Refuge Association, who provides us with money and support and volunteers. Anybody have any questions?
Well, I just have a comment. Yeah. And that is, as soon as you finish racing your homemade boat in the regatta, you call Terry and get ready for the crane pin work day.
I haven't set the date yet, but we will soon.
October 4th would be
yeah.
Can you tell me how similar or related are the American cranes to the European?
International Crane Foundation works on all of them. I'm not sure what they have in common with the other European cranes. The whooping crane is a marsh feeding crane, as opposed to the sandhill crane in this country, which is a field feeding crane. So a little bit different in there. But each of the cranes occupy different habitats. So, yeah. But they do a lot of the same work with the international cranes. If you ever go to the International Crane Foundation, they have almost every species in the world at International Crane Foundation. They do a lot of work on.
You said that that they give you some of the eggs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I had the same question I think this gentleman did. Are you getting eggs from European cranes?
No. They have the whooping crane separated. Most of the whooping cranes are artificially inseminated. Yeah. They don't usually throw two birds out there. Sometimes they do, but usually a lot of them are AI.
They got to learn.
Yeah, and they do that with some of them, but a lot of the birds, and they do have pairs there to stimulate the nesting and ovulation and stuff, but they do a lot of it through artificial insemination. So, and they do artificially push these birds to create a lot of eggs, so they take them away from them so that they continue to lay, which would not be something that would happen in the wild. So we put our captive flock under a lot of stress to create these eggs for us.
First 10 days, they're always incubated under a bird, whether it's a sandhill or a whooping crane.
And have you been down to Homosassa State Wildlife Park? That pair down there laid this year, but it wasn't infertile egg. They let her sit on it, though. They let them go through the process. After they handled it and determined it wasn't infertile egg, they let her sit on it through the entire incubating period to give her some practice. So we may have eggs coming out of there in the future.
Coyote depredation a concern for the cranes?
We have not had any of our birds taken by a coyote that we know of. I think it is up in the Mesita. They have issues with coyotes
really?
And wolves in some of the Wisconsin areas. But down here, we've not had that.
Do you know what your coyote situation is?
Oh, we have coyotes in the area. Do
you have a lot of them, or you don't know? It's such a big refuge.
Yeah, we haven't done any population surveys of them, but we do have coyotes out there. But I've seen coyotes in the marsh. The bobcats are more stealth and coming up on them, more stealthy and coming up in the marsh and hiding in the grass.
So. Right. A huge problem with coyotes and shorebirds.
We have it on St. Vincent too.
That's right.
St. Vincent,
right.
We have them with coyotes. But for some reason, they just don't seem to keep on the cranes.
Yeah.
What's the normal life expectancy of the working crane?
How old is the one up at Patuxent, Colleen?
I think in the wild, 20 or 30 years, and more than 50.
She's 50, yeah. She's still alive. I don't think she's laying anymore. I think they pulled her off production, but they do have one in captivity at the fact that he's over 50. So that's kind of some of the stuff that happens with endangered species. They're longer-lived birds, they're slower maturing, and they're lower reproductive rates. Now, a lot of the whooping cranes were almost hunted to extinction, and now we've lost their habitat, so we've done two double whammies on whooping cranes that caused them to go further into extinction, but you know, a lot of the endangered species have those things in common. That they're slow to mature, and same thing with eagles. Eagles don't nest until they're 4 or 5 years old. We brought them back from extinction, so we have hope for the whooping cranes, but it's a long-lived bird. Yeah. You about to say any other questions?
Here.
Yeah.
So, do you think this past year with the I guess four birds in total predated by coyotes? Do you think that's just anomaly, or has there been
the rest of the program, we've only had two other birds that were taken by predators. The rest of them, we've not had any problem. We did have one chick taken this year. All the birds that have been taken were outside the pen. We've not had a problem with predators, except for the one time we had to catch the alligator in the pen. But, he didn't take anything. He just hung out.
You're not supposed to talk about that.
Yeah.
But exactly. wouldn't that risk exist almost anywhere else?
It does, and that's kind of the argument that we have. So I said it's going to be a very interesting meeting in September. That's the argument I made, that anywhere that you take the birds, there are going to be predators. It is more open. One of the places they're considering is Wheeler National Wildlife Refuge in Decatur, which has its own issues in the fact that it's divided by an interstate. It has an interstate that runs right through the whole refuge. There's a lot of sandhill cranes, so I just said there's differences between the way the sandhill cranes and the whooping cranes should be actually behaving, so do we really want to mix in a lot of sandhill cranes? My biggest complaint about Wheeler is those birds are going back to Nisida. And if our birds that we brought down as chicks hook up with those adults and go back to Nisida, we have not moved them out of the problem nesting area. We need to have them mixing with birds at White River. All the birds that are coming back here go to White River, but they don't come down the pen. The 2009 birds stay at the Southwood. So that's a big problem. Yeah.
I was just going to say we take two more questions and then have some wine and cheese and we can thank you all you want.
Yeah.
The birds go to Gainesville area, right? Also.
Those are the ones that are in the Gainesville area are the remnants of the Florida non-migratory population. Some of our birds will go over there. I think one of the non-migratories actually followed one of our birds back to Nisida one time.
Yeah.
So occasionally the birds that were brought in the Chaz will go over there. But they did try a non-migratory population here in Florida. And they're attempting one in Louisiana right now, which is the competition for the birds.
You know, so that trend of predators, storms, and all kinds of things down there.
Yeah, it's a lot of learning when you come out of the zoo and you're released out into the wild. So, yeah.
I just want to put a plug in. This year's class was flown to White River Marsh last Thursday.
Right.
So if you're up early and want to watch our camera, they're training behind the ultralight about 7:30 our time.
Well, are they going to try to do anything about the black fly problem at Nisida?
They tried this year pushing, that they did a study this year where they were trying to take the eggs out of the nest so that they could push the birds to, because a lot of times they'll re-nest, so they were pulling eggs out of a half nest to push the birds to a later nesting.
What about the black flies themselves? Why did
really,
they just
you know, it's such a large area. They did a treatment one year and it did help somewhat. But really, do you really want to be putting pesticides out on an annual basis inside the rivers up there? You know, it's not a very, you know, eventually we're going to have to walk away and have a hands-off on this population where they can survive themselves. And so they're hoping that by pushing them to later nesting, they'll push them outside the black fly nesting. I mean, some of these guys come up there and start building their nest in the snow. So they're trying to push them a little further along in the nesting chronology. And so but then we had 30 nests this year hatched.
Like we had a lot of hatchlings, but only four surviving, and none of them are old enough to have fledged yet. So it's not just black flies.
Yeah, we've got to find some way to get a race control to adult people. So
thank you so much.
No problem.